you who gives me strength. Oh, nothing is impossible. Through you, my life will open. Strongholds are broken. Living by faith.
Oh, we sing.
Nothing is impossible.
Up your voices, say thank you, Lord. Praise.
heard your prayer as you come through for you again and again and again, met your needs, healed your body, delivered you from problems, protected you and kept you. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. Lord, we give you all the praise, all the thanks, all the glory for all the good things you have done for us. Truly, you are a good God to us. Thank you so much. We come before you, Lord, today, seeking your face, acknowledging your goodness. Thank you for your presence in our midst. And we want to hear your words, and we want to know your will and your ways. And so we ask for these things, and we know it's your will to give it to us. So we know that you heard us. So we know that we have the petitions we desired of you. And so we say, thank you. Oh, I will always. Never fail me, and you never will.
That's what I believe.
Ha ha! Ha ha! Is there supposed to be some life in a church that worships the living God? Oh, I will always. A dead Savior or a dead religion. We serve a living God. We serve a risen Savior, soon to come again. And I will always,
always
trust you.
Trust you.
Cause you have never failed me. Well, smile at somebody close by, and if they're running low on joy, give them some of yours. Say, here, have some joy. Have some joy. Have some joy. Have some joy.
Y'all are happy to be in church today. Yes, glory to God. It's a great day. Yes, 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 glory to God. Well, we're happy to be in church too. We've got some good reports today. You're going to be even more excited before the day is over. Yes, 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 yes. Well, do we have anybody here for the very first time today at Faith Life Church? If you would please wave your hand or stand up, whatever. We want to welcome you proper. Yes, yes, yes. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I think we got a whole family here. Somebody might want to pay off your house. You might want to stand up. So welcome, welcome, welcome. Yeah, there you go. There you go. Welcome. Yeah. There you go. He is not dumb in here this morning. Yes. Smart people we have. Yes, yes, yes. Well, you're looking nice today. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Well, it's a great day. Let me make a couple of announcements, then I'll tell you a couple of other things. For those of you who do not know, in Branson next week, does anybody know what's going on? Celebration Sunday. You know, we moved it further out. It's our, does anybody remember 20? We're 22 years old. Yeah, me too. Yeah, I claim it. 22 years old in Branson. On Resurrection Sunday, we were 22 years old, and so we're going to be celebrating. They have a few announcements they wanted me to make. They're going to have a volunteer meeting next Friday, May the 17th. So everybody there paying attention, slap your neighbor. No, don't slap them. Wake them up. See if they're paying attention. Volunteer meeting next Friday night, May the 17th. And if you're able to serve and you haven't signed up, we could use just a few more to make sure that everybody doesn't have to serve too long so they can enjoy the day themselves. So there's still a few opportunities. So go back to the information counter. And then they could use a few mighty men. We have mighty men there and here that they could use this week. If you're available throughout the week, go and sign up. And then one more very important message. Do not bring your pets. Now, me, I really like my pets a lot. I will say love my pets because I do love them. But don't bring them to the meet because there are people and little kids that are afraid of them. And besides that, the county does not like us having dogs around our food. So we want to please the county so we can do it again next year, right? And everybody in Branson said... A few of them said amen, but anyway, everybody there said amen. No pets next Sunday. All right, and then we had a couple of departures. We had one from Branson, our brother Dan Foster. He went home to be with the Lord on Saturday, May the 11th. Our Branson family, so you guys there, we'll be announcing more about the service later. And then here in Sarasota, we had Miss Eleanor Faye Smith. Correct me if I'm wrong, she was 93? Yes. And you guys can love on her family here. Love on Mark and Lisa Miller. Yeah, 93. She lived a good life, right? Yes, good long life. All right, birthdays or anniversaries here, there. Stand up if you would. Yes. Birthdays, anniversaries, yes. Yes, yes, yes. Stand up, don't be shy. Stand up, keep standing, keep standing, keep standing, keep standing, keep standing. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday, happy anniversary. One, congratulations, guys. Congratulations. Birthday, happy birthday. Anybody else that we're missing? Oh, over there, happy birthday. Okay, let's see Branson. Y'all see anybody? There's one standing. They're popping up now. Popping, popping. Okay. 22, JJ and Bambi. Happy anniversary. Can y'all see anybody else? Oh, birthday on the front row. Oh, anniversary. Oh, whoa, whoa. Little sister. Oh, yeah, they're from here. That's Pete and Evie. Happy anniversary. Okay, wait, 36. And next to them is a birthday, I believe. And birthday, 10, 11. What is that? Let's see. 1, 11. I got it. All right. Happy anniversary. 8. Congratulations. Are we missing anybody else? Janet. Happy, happy birthday. Anybody else? I guess it's not mine, so we're done with that. Glory to God. Well, you know, it's Mother's Day today. Glory to God. And Keith will come up here, and we'll celebrate it in just a minute. But I wanted to take just a minute. And I was thinking this morning as I was getting ready about my spiritual mothers and what a blessing they were in my life. And I had the privilege, and I never want to not remember what a blessing they were to me. I had the joy and privilege of being with Mom Hagen for decades. And I've had the joy and privilege of being with Miss Gloria for decades. And you never want to discount all those things and all the treasures that you have in people that God has put in your life. I think back on the things that I've learned from them, But I also think back on, I was thinking about one of the very first times I was around Mom Hagen. And the very first thing that she did with me was correct me. And the reason that I say that is because you can get offended early in what God has called you to do and walk away from what God wants you to do and be and never fulfill what God has called you to do and be. Because the very first thing she did to me, and I didn't know her at all, she called me to the side of the platform after a main service and looked me square in the eye and said, "What are you doing?" And I didn't know what she meant. It was during a big meeting. And she made a beeline for me. She was on this side of the platform, and I was on this side of the platform. And I said, "I'm sorry. I don't know what you mean." And she said, "What are you doing?" Just briskly. And I always basically had never been around her, so was a little bit intimidated by her and really honored her. And to get that, I was put off. And I said, "I'm sorry, I don't know what you mean. Why aren't you always in church with Keith?" Why aren't you always doing things with him? And I said, "Well, I'm working. I'm making the money so he can do these things." She didn't like that answer. See how quiet you are? Did she like the answer? She didn't like the answer. She said, "Well, I just want you to know this. There's a lot of good-looking women here in this school." Now, this is my first meeting with her. My first meeting with her. She says, "There is a lot of good-looking women in this school, and you got a good-looking husband. And the devil wouldn't mind getting mixed up in the middle of that. If you don't want to lose him, you might better stay a little bit closer than you are." And that was the end of that conversation. She turned and she walked away. Later years, I was privileged and honored to be one of the closest people to Mom Hagen that there was. I could have very easily gotten offended that night and said, "What business is it of hers? She don't know me. I'm working so he doesn't have to work. I'm working so he can do and help and be." But I didn't. I took it to heart, and I didn't get offended, and I didn't get hurt. I received what the woman of God had to say for me. You really have to guard your heart and not let offenses get in order to accomplish what God has for you in this life. Amen. Can you say amen? Amen? And the reason I'm saying that is because I learned so much from her. And I could tell you some things about Gloria the same way. They were both, I love them dearly to this day, but they never minced words with me. Ever. And I could have got offended a lot of times, but I'll stand here and try not to cry. But I treasure to this day every moment that I got to spend with them. Every moment that I got to spend with them. But I never, for one moment, got offended at anything that they corrected me about. And they corrected a lot. I treasure it. Can you say amen?
Amen?
Or say, "Oh me," as Brother Hagen used to say all the time anyway. Glory to God. I just thought I'd share that with you this morning because it came up strong in my heart this morning.
Praise God. Amen. Good, good. Thank you, Lord. Well, it's Mother's Day. And we're talking about honoring mothers. And this fluffy, romantic, ceremonial mother thing is not all there is to it.
That's right?
God intended much, much more. Yes. And that He used mothers and fathers to be a stability and wisdom and all kind of things, because they started before we did. Right? And God's given them a place in our life. So everybody say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
For godly mothers.
Godly mothers.
Amen. That includes your natural and your spiritual.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, it's offering time.
Hallelujah.
I think. Let's do this first. Yes. Since we're talking about mother. Yeah. Let's do this first. Thank you. That's why you need help, you know. Well, you laughing about it. You need help too.
Yes, sir.
All the mothers in the room, would you please stand? Let us acknowledge you, all the mothers in the room and in Branson. And would you please stand? And we have a small token of appreciation we want to hand out to you. So ushers, go ahead and get these real quickly. And if you would just remain standing for a bit, and we're going to speak over you, pray over you, and we're going to do something else too, apparently.
Yeah, who is the oldest mother in here? Wave your hand, since you're all standing. We got somebody that's 90. Back there in the back. 90? 95. All right.
95.
If you guys can, if anybody's available, Dan, go ahead and get those for her. And then we got the youngest. Who is the youngest mother? We got somebody 19. Twenty-one, yell out. 22. 23. 24. 24. Over here. Over here. All right. Keep your hand up and Dan will get to you. Over here on this side, Dan. All right. Who has the most kids? Oh. Who has, let's say, 7 kids? 7. Who has more than 7? Anybody with more than 7? Oh, okay. Who has, how many do you have? 7. Does anybody have 8? Over here, 8. Anybody have 9? Oh, somebody has 9? Anybody have 10? 9?
9.
9 going once? 9 kids over here. You know, my grandmother had 11. Yeah. 9. Okay, who's our newest mother? Anybody have one a month old? 6 months? A year? Back a year, okay. Back here, all right. Right there, Dan. All right. And We're forgetting about Branson. I hope they're getting somebody.
No, the same time.
I know, but yeah. Did they have somebody 10 years and 9? I hope that Dave's catching them over there.
Yeah.
Hope he's running fast. He was? Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. Who's been in Sarasota the longest, a mother? Has somebody been here 10 plus years?
Yeah.
Mother, oh, we got lots of them, so we better not do that. We better not do that. Okay, we better stop here then. All right. We love you all, every single one of you. Congratulations on Mother's Day.
Amen. Remain standing. Mothers, would you please remain standing? We want to pray over you and speak over you and bless you. And not only those here, but mothers that are not here, of those who are in the services, we can pray over them and God will touch them there as well. This is a jewelry travel box, I guess is what it is, right? Or whatever you want it to be, right? Well, everybody in the congregation that's seated, reach your hands out towards these that are standing and let's give thanks and let's pray over these. Father, we thank you so much for the mothers in our lives, our natural mothers, our spiritual mothers. Truly, they are gifts from you that are beyond price. Thank you so much for everything that you have put into them, everything that you have ministered to us through them, everything you have given to us in them. We speak blessings and increase and grace over their lives. And we pray, Lord, that their latter days would be better than their former days. And every mother that's not here, but that is a mother of someone that is here, wherever they may be in the country, in anywhere in the world, we ask that your presence would minister to them too and quicken them and bless them and strengthen them and help them. We speak healing over their bodies. And we speak quickening in their brains and in their minds and in strength in their souls and inner man. Everybody said out loud, we bless you.
We bless you.
All of our mothers.
We bless you.
And speak strength over you.
Love and grace.
Joy and peace.
Be to you.
In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You can be seated. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Praise God. Praise God. What a gift a good mother is. Hallelujah. Beyond price. That's one thing Proverbs said, right? But beyond price. Hallelujah. Would you put up on the screen, or you can go to if you have a Bible in hand, John 14 and verse 13, it's offering time and also report time on our project, of course, of things that have been going. Hallelujah. John 14, 13, I was reminded of this. Jesus said, the Master said, whatever you shall ask in my name, that will I do. That the Father may be glorified in the Son. Next verse. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. How are we to take that?
Literally.
Huh?
Literally.
Seriously?
Yes.
Right? Does anything mean that? Does I will do it mean he will do it?
Yes.
If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Well, we ask the Lord to do some things.
Yes.
In our projects. And he did them. I said he did them. Would you... put down the screen for us. I do want to show the other video one more time. Because for those of you not with us, back in October, which is just a little over 6 months ago, we released faith for what we called a step up. Step up. And boy, that has come to mean so much more to me in the months following. I didn't realize how big a step it was and how much of a stretch it would be. But do you know what pleases God?
Faith.
Faith. And playing it safe and being passive and trying to just stay comfortable is not how it works. You got to step out. And when you step out is when you find out. Not before. Not until. Now when I say step out, I'm not talking about just doing something that, you know, off the top of your head. I'm talking about seeking God, hearing from Him, and then doing what He said to do. The only way you can have faith in God is that you have heard from God. Amen. That's the only way. Amen. Faith comes by hearing. But this video will show that we have been traveling outside of the U.S. as well as inside the U.S. And 42 or 3 years ago, we started in the traveling ministry. And then Black Phyllis just announced 22 years ago, we started the church in Branson. And then I guess it'd be 12 years ago, this church. But the Lord didn't release us from traveling. We continued to do that as well. And so in 1996, we released faith to get an aircraft. And we got a little small, I don't know if you know what a Bonanza is, but it's a single engine propeller, very small. But that's all, you know, we had faith to operate at that time. And we went all over the country and Canada and everywhere in that thing and preached to everybody that would stand still. And then we moved up to another one and to another one and to another one. And then eventually into turbine aircraft that were fast. And then eventually this last one, 8 some years ago, that you could cross an ocean with. And so we have done that for the last 8 years or so, going to different countries. And one reason that we felt impressed to invest more into it is how well these international meetings have gone. We've had, we'd have sometimes, hundreds of ministers come from 5 surrounding countries to be in the meeting with us. And we laid hands on them, prayed over them. And sometimes the head of ministry, some of these people, like you see me laying hands on one of these guys, he was over, 400 churches throughout that region. The other guy was the king of the islands that were there. And we just had no problems. And everything was covered and all the expenses were covered and we were able to get there easily and then get home easily a lot of times and speak on a Sunday, even though we did. So we just knew the Lord's hand is on it and so that we should do more of it. And so we're investing more into it. So go ahead and show that video. And this is just a snapshot of the past 8 years. Verse 11, He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. And with every generation, the Lord tarries His coming. Those who are elders and leaders, they grow older, they finish their race, they pass off the scene, and in those who used to be younger are supposed to become the elders, is that right, of the next generation. And this is what the Lord gave me in prayer. It is an international outreach of ministry. We've already been doing some of those things, but it's to provide resources to do even more. And a lot of what we've been doing is ministering to ministers in these places. That's been much on my heart since I began in the ministry back in the early 80s. Lord, I've always had that on my heart to minister to ministers, but what can I do? How can I do it? Now, I'm looking for what else to do. And that came up to me again. Lord, what can I do for those that would look to me for eldership, leadership? And he brought to my mind something he said to me decades ago. He said, I told you, and he told me just like he had told me 5 minutes ago. And it was the most valuable thing you have to give is a revelation of the word I give you. If you speak to people in words they don't understand, how will they know what you're saying? What's the answer? They won't. And if they don't hear it, how will they believe? They can't. And if they don't believe, will they call on the Lord and be saved? And be saved is not just the new birth. Sozo salvation includes healing, deliverance, provision, protection, everything. When you said saved, saved from what? We're not only saved from hell. We're saved from the curse of the law. We're saved from a life of misery and defeat. We're saved. How many want everybody in every language that should know at least what we've learned about faith and how it has changed our life so radically? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Anybody remember what the Great Commission is?
Go.
Go where? Into all the world. And do what? Proclaim. Preach the good news to everybody. Hallelujah. Well, you know, one or two ministries or churches can't do that. But if all of us do our part, then the job gets done. And when the last folks are saved and the living stones put into the dwelling place of God, this thing winds up. Hallelujah. So, hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. I'm so thankful and blessed this morning, I hardly know where to go next. Back 6 months ago in our, when we launched our Step Up project, we've been so happy with this equipment, this plane. It has done such a great job. But it's 25 years old now, and it's coming up on its big inspections, and it's time to invest a lot into it if we are going to keep it going forward. And so, the Lord prompted me, started to begin dealing with me about stepping up. And so it actually took a while for me to get on board with that. But we did. We released faith. There's the same company that makes this plane, makes one a little bit bigger. It's not that much bigger in size, but it goes a lot further. And it's all digital, so it's upgradable. They actually have a modification out for that model now that you can take the very latest, greatest software and hardware that's in the brand new plane and put it in the older plane. Amen. And make it just like a brand new one. And you can't do that with the one we have now. It's just too much of a difference. So we released faith for the this one's big brother. And we thought that with our project and with the sale or trade of the one we have now, that we could get one of these. Not a new one, but a one a few years old. One that would be probably 10 years newer than what we've got now. And so we released faith for that. And at the end of that week and then a few months later, we were at about 67%. Of that project. And my thought was that during greater faith, we would maybe complete that. But that was just my thought. Right. One day when I was praying, The Lord dealt with me about a ministry of our friends down in Brisbane, Australia, and how they have a Bible school there. And then they have now, I think, 3 Bible schools in Papua New Guinea. You talk about mission field. That's mission field. And they've just done a great job down there, but they didn't have a place of their own. And last time I was there, that was in one of those slides you saw that we were there. It came up in our heart about believing with them to not just have to pay rent always. And, you know, you can get kicked out anytime if it's not yours. And so we released faith. All of us did during Greater Faith for $3 million. We knew it'd take more than that, but that would help them to secure something maybe and then take the next step. Well, with the the monetary exchange in the currency, that all came in. Of course, that didn't go to this project. It went to them. But with the currency exchange, and then they had an additional, I don't know, was it 500,000 come in down there to them, people that heard what was happening here, sowed to them from Australia. And they had new families come to the church because they said they didn't know they were there. And they heard about, they were in Australia, but they heard about Australia from Branson. And Sarah, so isn't this amazing? But with the currency exchange, that $3.5 million turned into nearly 5. So what a great seed that is. And great things are happening to them. And they just sent us a testimony, I don't know, a while back, that said one of the guys they were doing business with that had been a little slow or a little stiff, he got saved. He got born again. That's bigger than the whole deal. Is that right? So anyway, we prayed and said, Lord, you are well able to help us to redeem our time. We're not just going to go and look at a bunch of aircraft and take a bunch of time and travel and spend money. You know what we need. So guide us to it. And so we only looked, we only went and looked at 2. And the one we made a deal with is the one we got, one of those. And interesting, I think what the other one was just to kind of help us know the difference. The other one was a great price and low time, and there was a lot to like about it, but we went to see it, and I was in the cockpit, Mike and I with the pilot, and Phyllis went back in the back. And about 5 minutes, I turned around, and she's gone. I thought, well, where'd she go? I took a few more minutes and finished up with those guys, but she had gone back to our plane and said, you know, I don't like it. I said, something's a check. Well, I had the same thing. And so, I don't know, what, a month later, Mike was talking to someone who was an expert with helping us assess this one. And he brought up that particular one, and that guy looked at him and said, don't get it. Well, how would you know that? We wouldn't know, but the Spirit of God knows everything.
That's right.
And then we had a prompting. We had thought we'd have to sell ours or, you know, trade somehow. And it came up in our hearts that the Lord could help us to just get this one. Not that we're going to keep the other one per se, but you know how even if it's a car deal, you usually lose money on a trade.
That's right.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So if you can sell yours for a good price and then you got cash to negotiate with on the other, you can come out way ahead. Right. And so these people were willing to just sell it straight at a good price, which we negotiated down another $1.5 million. But the issue with that is we didn't have the money to pay that. We thought, well, if our project would complete, we would have the money. It'd be tight, but we'd be right there. And so do we have the graphics of back when we started this 5 weeks ago? Do we have the graphic of that? Can you show? Yeah. Just 5 weeks ago, this is where we were. A month. And a week. We were at 67%. And then the next week, we had this come in. It was about $400,000 or $500,000. And then the next week, we had another $500,000 or $600,000. And the next week, we had, I think it was $600,000 or $700,000. And then the next week, we had this. And then last week, we had this. And this was enough. This was enough for us to close the deal.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Now, we still need, you know, believing for the balance, you know. There are some things we need to do after the sale, and there's some tools and jacks and a number of things we need to do, and so that'll be good towards that. Huh? I just noticed that one.
It's
yeah, it's 200 more than that is what it is. There's a mistake on that. Huh? No, it's 500 some thousand remaining instead of three. Instead of three. There was a question about something. So the actual balance is 520 or 571. This is a mistake on the graphic. The actual balance is 571. But with what we had and the savings and what have you, we were able to close the deal. So we got another video for you. We got a new video. Huh? They got it right now. That's the actual balance. Yeah. Psalm 118:23, it says, "This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." And I had forgotten that this was the very next verse. It says, "Save now, I beseech you, O Lord. Send now prosperity." It's the very next verse. Our success. "Blessed be he that comes in the name of the Lord. We've blessed you out of the house of the Lord." It ends up by saying, "You are my God, I will praise you. You are my God, I will exalt you. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever." So, Father, we do. We lift our hands and our hearts and our minds, and we acknowledge, Lord, we would not have this.
unless you had done it for us. And we have seen miracles just in this past month. Thank you for enabling us to do everything that has brought us to this point. And we thank you for this equipment, and we thank you for the ability that it brings.
Thank you.
So just Phyllis, are you here? Just reach your hands out toward this. And Father, all of us in Jesus' name, we receive this equipment into the ministry. And we say it'll serve you now. It will accomplish your purposes, your trips, your plans. We dedicate it for the furtherance of the gospel. We dedicate it to accomplish the Great Commission. And we say it's in the ministry now. Ministering spirits, you have charge concerning it. You do keep us in all of our ways. And every evil spirit, every foul spirit, we say it is off limits to you. You cannot do anything with it. We forbid you from interfering with it, bothering it, hurting it in any way. We pray, Lord, that everybody that would ever fly on it or be around it, that you would keep them, protect them, prosper them, minister to them your peace, your presence. And we call this plane blessed. Bless it in the name of Jesus. It will serve us well and safely, and as long as we own it, and will be nothing but a blessing to us in Jesus' name. And we pray, Lord, over all of our partners and all of our church family that sowed into this and continue to. We bless them, and we say, Lord, help them to lay hold of abundant harvests of like kind, every one that has sown good seed into this good ground. And they have a part, Lord. Everywhere we go, every trip, every service, they have a part of it. And we thank you for eternal reward for them. We bless them, we speak increase over them, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Woo! Leave it down. We're going to have some pictures to show. What do you think? What do you think? My. They delivered it, and within an hour, we had transferred funds and paid for it. Cash. Just paid for it. You know, and Phyllis showed you, what was it, last Friday on our faith adventure, when we first started, we had to borrow the money for the down payment to borrow the money on a $3,500 mobile home. What can God do for you? And he'll do it for anybody. Anybody. There's just no end. What did we just get through reading? What did the Lord say? If you ask anything,
anything.
In my name. I'll do it. We asked him to do this.
Yes.
And he did it.
Amen.
I said he did it.
Yes.
Glory to God.
Glory to God.
I have just been I've just been crying and thanking God and praising.
It's,
that's just a machine, but his goodness, his graciousness, that's the thing. When I saw how this was happening, I told you this a few weeks ago, that there was a moment, I just had a flash of where God had brought us from and how he had used us to do some of these things. I was overwhelmed by the goodness of God. And the Lord spoke to my heart. And he said to me, he said, I don't mean I heard a voice, but inside very distinctly, he said, if you, and I know when he said you, he meant all of us, you, his people. If you're not frequently overwhelmed by the goodness of God, you're not fully living the good life he prepared and made ready for you to live. Do you believe that? Does that bear witness with you? Because he is able to do
exceeding abundantly above all that you ever asked or thought. Glory to God. Glory to God. So this equipment enables us to do what we've been doing even better. It's it has over 1,000 miles more range, and it's faster, and it doesn't burn much fuel, and it's upgradable. And so basically from either Branson or Florida, anywhere in Europe, nonstop. Come home, you know, Spain, France, Estonia, you saw, nonstop. Come home, nonstop. And you know, that's one thing that I had in mind. You know, 10 years from now, the Lord tarries is coming, I'll be 75. And that's with the Lord sustaining us, keeping us. And you know, if I finish preaching in Estonia on a Thursday night or whatever, and want to come home,
yes,
huh? I might just want to go lay down in the back. Take a nap, and the next thing you know, when you land, you're home. And that kind of thing, you'll wind up doing more. And this encourages me to go more, to give more, to do more. And how many think that's a good thing, in being encouraged and being strengthened? And so like we said, it's a few years old, but it's a lot newer than what we had. But it's less than a third of the price of a new one. And it'll do everything that the new one will do. Don't we have some pictures? I believe we had a few pictures. Okay, I think that was supposed to be the last one. But they should be numbered. But go ahead, it doesn't make that much difference. That's it. And keep going, the next one. You see that rail on the door? They only come with one rail. But you can order another one if you're willing to pay for it. And there are 20 options that the Lord gave us on this. There were like 15 that we knew we wanted and had asked for and wrote down. Got all of them.
Thank you, Jesus.
And there were like another 5 we didn't even know we wanted. We thought, oh yeah, yeah, that's the thing right there. And that extra rail, it may not look like much, but that's a big deal. Go ahead. This is the cockpit. And like we had said, this is all digital. This is the new stuff, and it's fully upgradable. And like you can see, there's no yoke anymore. You know, it's a joystick on the side like you play your video game with, you know. And if you can see up on the left, that's what they call a HUD, heads-up display. That's right out of fighter jets. And so you when you're coming in for a landing and the weather's not good, you don't even have to look down here. All your information is front of your eyes, and it's got infrared. So even when you can't see through the screen, usually the runway is warmer than the surrounding area, and so it stands out. And if a deer ran across it, you'd see the deer through that. So it's really neat stuff. That's an option.
Wow.
And a big one.
Yes.
And we've got, yeah, actually that's what I wrote down. I got a list, and a big red letter said, we got it, 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 we got it. And then I had another sublist said, we got that too. Because that was not something we even knew. We got that too, we got that too. So that's the cockpit. And one thing about that, this plane will fly 12 hours at a time. And that's a long time.
Yeah.
And these seats will lean and they will move and they're more comfortable. And you got more room. You're not so straight up and all that. Anyway, go to the next one. This is just another shot, a little different angle of that. And continue. How about that? Yeah, very, very comfortable. Go ahead next. Just a different shot. These, see that couch there? You press a button and it lays down flat into a bed. And you can take your pillow and we got it. We got it. That was one thing we wanted. And the electric, because the other ones are a little cumbersome. Sometimes they hang up. This you just push a button. Yeah. We got it. That may be a phrase you hear again. We got it. Go ahead. Yeah. And it's long enough you can stretch out, man. It's plenty of room. Keep going. Yeah. It's I think it's 7-8 foot longer than the one we got. It's got more room inside. Keep going. Now, this is something that's extra. Most we got it. You see the roll top panel, like where you'd keep your loaf of bread, you know, there. Usually they only have either two of those. This one has an extended galley. And so it's got extra stuff, and it even has a chiller, a refrigerator, which is rare. But we got it.
We got it. We got it.
And
double portion.
Continue. That's the bathroom.
Wow.
In the back. And another thing we wanted, because a lot of times people don't carry dress clothes like we do, but we carry a lot of hanging bags. And if you can hang them up, then they're good shape when you get there. You know, not crumpled, you don't have to iron all that. We wanted an extra hanging closet. This one has a third bigger luggage, and it's got three extra closets to hang. Four, Phyllis says four. But two in the back, two in the front, that's right. Where you could hang stuff. And a lot of them don't have a good place to hang stuff. So we've just been thanking God.
Thank you,
God. And the next one, I think that's about it. But that's an external shot. But how about let's all stand up and thank God for... Oh, Father. Gracious, good, kind Father. We are so thankful that we have found out that you are so good. And that you have taught us to look to you and not be afraid to ask for big things. And not be afraid to step out and sow bigger and think bigger and believe bigger. Thank you for this equipment. Thank you for all the folks that have sown into this and prayed over us and believed with us. We give you thanks. Thank you. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can be seated. The offering this morning will just all go to general. Unless you want it to go to the project, you can designate that. But as you might understand, we haven't had a general offering in 5 weeks. But that's another miracle. We paid all the bills, right? We've had everything we needed. It stretched us. But we're on the other side of it. And think about how much money we're not having to pay on interest. Because it's paid for. It's paid for. And this thing could be great and good for, you know, at least the next 10 years. We'll see, but so the offering will just be general unless you designate it something else. So ushers, wait on the people. If you want to get involved by cash or credit card today, raise your hand. Take an envelope. If you want to give by check, make it out to FLC. Text to give is there on the screen. Watching online, there's a button that says sowing. You can get involved that way. And what I really want to encourage you about is being in faith about the seed you have sown. Because every good seed in the good ground should produce after its own kind. And maybe you're not believing for that, but there's something like that.
Amen.
Something that is a step way up.
Amen.
A step way up that you could not make happen by yourself. But the Lord can make it happen. And He will. And this thing that you've already sown into and what we've seen finished and is finishing now, it is a finishing seed. It is a step up seed, right? And so you want to be ready when the Lord shows you the next thing in your life, your business or whatever it is, that you go ahead and reach out for it and step up.
Amen.
And when you step up, your vision is changed. You can see things you couldn't see down lower.
Amen.
And when you step up, your reach has increased.
Amen.
You can reach things
Amen.
You couldn't reach down lower.
Amen.
So, fellas and I and the staff are particularly stirred up. Come on. Oh my, there's so much to tell. There's so much to tell. We reached a bit of a sticking point in the negotiations at one point. It was already the lowest price on the market. But we're just endeavoring to be led. And of course, up until last week, we didn't have it. So there was an individual involved in it said, well, they have some parts that might be a negotiating point. And so just by faith, we said, okay, because we knew they bought it new. And they'd had it for years. And they were a big company, and so they could afford to keep a bunch of spares. Well, these parts, as you might imagine, are not cheap.
Right.
And so without even knowing the details, we said, okay, if you'll give us your spares as part of the deal, we'll agree to that price. Turns out it was about $500,000 worth of parts.
Wow.
Yay. and they agreed.
And we got it.
They agreed. And just such favor, such favor. Every time we go to do something, we didn't make it hard with them. They didn't make it hard with us. We saved a bunch of money on the inspections. It's just, you can see the Lord all the way through it. Just everything we need. Was that what you're talking about? Yeah. So, of course, that makes the purchase price less. Because you got all this. And then when you need to get them, they're sitting right there ready to go. So things like tires and wheels and valves and, you know. Yay. We've already got a trip scheduled in 2 weeks. We're supposed to be in Mexico City for graduation and some other things. And we could, one reason we could do it, they called and said, hey, our main speaker couldn't go. And so they thought about us because they thought we could get there quick. And we said, okay. Yeah. And now it's here. So let's go. And can come home quick too. So if you're ready, stand with us. Phyllis, come and bring your offering. I know we're taking a little extra time today, and but we got something to celebrate, something to be thankful for. Everybody, whether you're sowing or not, just stand with us and worship the Lord. And if you don't have anything to give but you'd like to, hold up your hand, even though it might be empty, and the Lord will, He'll give you seed to sow. The scripture said, hold up your hand, hold up your offering. Said out loud, Father God,
You are so good,
so good
to us.
Thank you
for meeting all our needs
according to Your riches
in glory
by Christ Jesus.
Thank you
for giving us richly
all things to enjoy,
for taking pleasure
in the prosperity
of Your people. We rejoice in it. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name. Lord, Phyllis and I speak over your people by the anointing of the place in our lives and your call that as they bring these things to you and concerning their seed they have already sown in days past. And we say, be blessed, be increased, be empowered to come up higher and go further and be stronger in every good thing and bear a lot of good fruit and fruit that lasts, that remains. We bless you in the name of the head of the church, Yeshua Jesus. Hallelujah. Somebody say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
What's going on in the Faith Life family? We're getting our buildings, our lands, our houses, our vehicles, and our equipments, and how? What else is going on? All of our debts are being reduced and eliminated. The Lord's bringing us into the best shape of our lives thus far. That enables us to give more, do more, help more. What else is going on? He's bringing into my hands seed, even some great big whopper chunk seed. And we saw that in these last 5 weeks, a number of large seeds. And to me, they just, there was some honor in those seeds.
Yes.
And there was some faith, and some other folks were stretching just like we were. And how many know God is not unrighteous to forget? He will not forget. And we will hear, you believe you have a lot of testimonies to read? We're going to hear some amazing, outstanding things about you. That was too weak. I said, we're going to hear some amazing, outstanding things about you.
Yes.
You.
Yes.
So I want to hear you go, yes.
Yes.
Me too.
Me too.
Amen. You can be seated. Ushers, wait on the people. We got it.
Yes.
6 months. 6 months. And in the middle of that one, did a project for somebody else. God can do it. Is that right? He can do it. There's no shortage with him. Father, all of us agree together for the rest of the service, asking for utterance, asking for the anointing, asking for eyes that see, ears that hear, hearts that understand, and exactly what you want us to see and how you want us to see it and what comes next. We ask for these things And we purpose not to be hearers only, forgetful hearers, but to be doers of what you say and show us. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Thanks, guys. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Would you look with me in the scriptures to 2 Timothy, the first chapter. I hear shouting over here. Well, it's time to shout, don't you think? It's definitely time to shout because some of these things, well, I'm trying to get ahead of myself now, so just hold that thought. 2 Timothy 1 and 5, the Spirit of God through Paul said, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that's in you, it dwelt first in your grandmother, Lois, and in your mother, some pronounce this Eunice, some of the things pronounce it Eunice. And I am persuaded that it's in you also, in you too. We're celebrating Mother's Day today. And this has to do with mothers. But it has to do with something that God passed on to someone through grandmother and mother. Now the Bible tells us, you know, that we are to honor father and mother. And Ephesians says that that commandment comes with a promise. That if you do, it'll go well with you. And you'll live long on the earth. That's pretty big. Right? It going well with you and living a long time. Why would that be? Well, because honor has to do with what you value, how you esteem, how you see something or someone, how you talk about them, refer to them, treat them, handle them. It's about, you know, we would call it respect, but it's more than that. And God intended that every tiny infant, even before birth, and then especially after, begin to learn about God through godly parents. Now that obviously hadn't always been the case, but that's His will. That's His plan. And God's perfect will would be for little ones to learn how to honor God by first honoring mother and father, and to learn about God through godly mothers and fathers.
Amen.
And to learn about how to live by faith and please God by watching godly mothers and fathers do that.
Amen.
Watching them walk with God, pray, praise and worship, put God first, go to church, sow, tithe, honor God, minister and help people, help the church, help preach the gospel, help people in need. Little ones are to learn by watching and hearing and then imitating and doing. That's how they learn the language. Right? Yeah. They didn't, you know, little ones, one-year-olds, two-year-olds, and they didn't take a course in English. They didn't learn about, you know, nouns and verbs and sentence construction. They heard people that they were around.
That's right.
And who are they around the most early on? Be their mother and their father and maybe their grandparents and other children and siblings. But they hear them say things and then they imitate them.
Right.
They see them do things and so then they imitate them.
Right?
Well, and that's just natural, and that's normal and good, but what one of the big things that should happen is they should see faith.
That's right.
They should hear faith.
Yes.
In mama and daddy, and in their siblings, and their grandparents, and uncles and aunts, and in the people they go to church with, and they should hear godly prayer. They should see and hear faith, praise, and worship. They should see walking in love. They should see these things so that they learn and imitate that.
Amen.
And become that.
Right.
True?
Yes.
And that's what he's saying here to Timothy. Now, Timothy is a big name in the New Testament. Mm-hmm. He was Paul's protege. Mm-hmm. He was his understudy. And but God started getting him ready long before he met Paul.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
Who?
Grandma.
Mama.
Right.
Granny. Right? And Mama.
Right.
Mother. Mom. What? He was learning about faith in God before he could tie his sandals.
Amen.
Right? Right? That's what he said. He said this faith, and he said, notice he mentioned a descriptor, unfeigned faith. Well, un means not feigned. Feign means to pretend. So the faith they had was the real deal. No article, pretend or religious article, but the real thing. Genuine faith in his grandmother and in his mother. You can leave no greater inheritance than faith in God.
Hallelujah.
Hmm?
Hallelujah.
Do you believe that?
Yes.
Because this doesn't just apply to one area of your life. This is from the time you open your eyes to the time you lay your head on the pillow. Right? And everything in between, the just shall live
by faith.
That's everything you do, all the time. And the Spirit of God, through Paul, is bringing up, for us to even talk about today, all these centuries later, and say, that faith got into you by being around them.
That's right.
Did you hear that?
Yes. Yes.
That faith got into you. Now, it's not automatic. It doesn't come just by osmosis.
Right. That's right.
That's right.
But unless you're exposed to it, you don't know anything about it.
That's right.
But if you are exposed to it, especially day after day, year after year, and you'll receive it, then the same great thing that's in them and on them gets in you.
Amen.
And can become even greater.
Yes.
Somebody say, thank you, Lord.
Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Philippians, if you'd go there, please, the 4th chapter. You know, I had a similar heritage. My grandmother and my mother had faith. My mother just went home to be with the Lord a month or two ago, whenever it was. But some of you have heard about my grandmother, if you've heard my preaching much. Her name was Sister Lena Pearl Moore. You know, down south we have double names, you know. If one is good, two's better. And my grandmother was the secretary treasurer and Sunday school teacher of the First Pentecostal Church there for, I don't know, 50, 60 years. And anyway, godly woman. God loved God. back when she was a young woman, of course, there were a lot of racial divides. This is the Deep South. And she and African-American folks and Choctaw Indian and other folks working in the cotton fields in central Mississippi, all of them were working there together, got filled with the Holy Spirit out in the cotton field. And so they couldn't have done this in some of the traditional religion churches, but they had outdoor meetings, and there were people with all different skin tones out there in these meetings praising and worshiping God beside a big pond where they did their baptisms. And they had a real experience with God. Nobody was making them do this. And so she, that's how she got started in the things of God. Well, this is before I, long before I was ever born. But when I was born, I remember such wonderful memories. This reminds me of this. Because there was a faith that dwelt in her. And still is. And as a little boy, I remember it. One of my earliest memories. I had on either a diaper or some kind of little short, but I didn't have a shirt on. And it was hot summertime in Mississippi. And I was in my grandma's arms, and we went out to the pear tree. And this pear tree was giant. Of course, when you're this big, everything looks giant too. But it was a big, old pear tree, and it was seasoned. And these pears, how many of us understand, ain't nothing like a sun-ripened, leave it on the tree till it's done. And so she's feeding me pears. And I remember, I got pear juice all down my, you know, my chest and my stomach, and I don't care. I got pear juice, and I am into these things. And I, she said this to me. I'm with the little guy in her arms. She said, and I don't know, a few years old, whatever. She said, Keithy, she called me. She said, aren't these pears great? Aren't they good and sweet? I went, you know. Something. And she said, God is sweeter than these pears.
Oh, wow.
I thought, he's got to be pretty sweet, you know. But I just ate another pear. here I am. You know, all these decades later, I'm still talking to you about this. Right? Did this make a mark on me?
Yes, it did.
It did. It did. And my granddad had Hereford cattle. And his prize bull was a great big, you know, Herefords are the reddish color with the big white face and curly, curly hair. And he had this big prize bull. Of course, again, when you're this tall, everything looks giant. And his name was Tom. And he kept him. And I always wanted to go see Tom, but I was too little. But she took me to see him one day. And I remember we got close. He was like a pet, even though he was giant. And I put my little hand up in the middle of his big head. And he thought you was going to feed him, so he'd come up close to you. And my grandmother said, see how big Tom is? I thought, he's the biggest thing I ever saw in my life. He's gigantic. She said, God is bigger than Tom.
Wow.
I thought, whoa. God's bigger than Tom. But see, that's a faith that was in her. She knew God, right?
Yeah.
And that got in me. And there were times I was awakened in our tiny little house where my mother was praying in the spirit. And I'd be awakened in the night. And it wasn't her praying loud that woke me up. It was the presence of God in the bedroom. And I'd just lay there and be quiet. And see, once you experience the presence of God, then you know that for yourself.
Right.
the rest of your life. But that was through association with people that are in your life that you're connected to. And it was not, it's no accident who is your mother and who is your grandmother. Now, I know that a lot of parents have not done right and have done a lot of wrong things, but God didn't tell you to honor them if they did everything right.
Right.
That's right.
Or if you think they qualified or not.
That's right.
Hmm?
That's right.
In honoring them, you honor Him. And that is the big deal. Can you say amen? Or
amen.
Philippians 4:9. Did you find that?
Yes.
Philippians 4:9 says, those things, and this is the Spirit of God through Paul, talking to people that came up under him, got saved up under, in his ministry, but especially all the ministers that came up under him. He said, the things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do it.
Amen.
Do what? Do what, everybody? Do what you learned around me.
Amen.
Do what you heard me say.
Amen.
Do what you saw me do.
Amen.
Is there a connection?
Yes.
An association?
Yes.
Do that, and the God of peace will be with you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The God of peace.
Yes.
And of course, that includes a whole bunch of things.
Amen.
Whew. Go to Romans, please. The 10th chapter. Romans 10. All these things are connected that we're talking about today. And I'm excited about a furtherance of them. Romans 10 and verse 11. It says, for the Scripture says, whoever believes in Him shall not be ashamed. You could also say, won't be disappointed. Won't be let down. Keep going. For there's no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon Him. Rich. I did a message on rich one time. And just using scriptures like this. And when I left the service, there was a guy waiting on me in the parking lot. And he was mad. Oh, he was mad. And he said, that ain't right. That ain't right. That rich stuff. That rich stuff. I said, which scripture are you talking about? I think that made him madder. I said, brother, I said, this is a scripture, right? Rich is God's idea.
Right.
Did I lose somebody? Huh? He gives us
richly
all things to enjoy. He's rich in mercy. He's rich to all that call on Him. They don't get any more rich than God. I know it's a four-letter word, but it's a good word. It's a God word. Now, you can get mad about it if you want to, but... And, of course, all these years later, I'm still preaching about it. He said, verse 13, whoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now notice these next verses. How then shall they call in Him, in whom call on Him, in whom they have not believed? Give me the answer to this, everybody. Now we're talking about salvation. That's what he mentioned twice, being saved. And being saved is the big word, sozo. We're not just saved from hell. We're saved from the curse of the law. We're saved from all kind of things. And but you won't be saved unless you call on the Lord. See, back up to the previous verse. Whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. Whoever. Doesn't matter where you're from, who you are, who your people are. If you would genuinely rise up in faith and call on the Lord, call on the name of the Lord, you'll be saved. Anywhere, anybody. But will you call on the Lord and be saved if you haven't heard about Him or believed in Him, I should say? No, you will not. Why? You cannot. You cannot. That's why God has ordained and chosen that human beings be saved by what the world calls the foolishness of preaching.
Amen.
And that is the Great Commission.
Hallelujah.
Go into all the world and what?
Preach.
Not feed people.
Amen.
Not clothe people.
No.
Not build housing.
No.
Huh? Now those things are good. But God never intended that one group of people be dependent on another group of people.
Amen.
Everybody can look to God for themselves.
Hallelujah.
Is that right?
Yes.
And the greatest need of man, human beings, is not natural.
Right.
It's spiritual. If you gain the whole world and lose your soul,
That's right.
What have you done? It's great to help people materially and naturally, but that's not the main thing they need.
Right.
That's not what will save. What will save is faith in the gospel and recalling on Him and receiving Him. But they won't call on Him in whom they've not believed. And how shall they believe in Him in whom they have not heard? What's the answer? Are you going to believe something you've never heard?
No.
So there had to be somebody that would tell it, that would declare it, that would preach it, that would teach it, so you could hear it, so you could believe it. And if you were never around anybody that preached it, you could never believe for it. Is this big?
Yes, sir.
And how will they hear without a preacher?
Amen.
What's the answer?
They
can't. They won't. Now see, a lot of preachers are despised.
Amen.
Especially by people, you know, that consider themselves intelligent with higher education and what have you. They think that, you know, religion is just an emotional crutch for poor, ignorant people that don't know the difference. And so they think everything, every dollar spent on a building or, services or meetings or broadcast or especially a plane or anything like that is a complete, total waste, because it should be used in helping somebody's physical, material need. But that's acting like there's no God.
Right.
And that's acting like you don't need to be saved. And that's acting like the gospel doesn't matter. Preachers are important.
Yes, you are.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Why? Tell me why they're important.
Because
you can't believe
unless
and until you hear.
Amen.
And you won't hear
unless
somebody preaches it.
Amen.
So get me a preacher.
Yes,
sir. Is that right? Get me a preacher quick. Right? Because we can't even get this thing moving. Right? We can't even get started. Until we start hearing something and start believing it and start acting on it. There will be no answers. There will be no miracles. And how shall they preach except they be sent? And that's sent by God. And it's also sent by the people that are raised up to send. Hallelujah. I was, I won't name the country, but so it was in this slide that you just saw a while back. And we flew in there and they came and picked us up. And they had two new vehicles. And they said, "Did you see our new vehicles?" We thought, wow, they're nice. They're brand spanking new. And this was a breakthrough, because in their area and their country, nobody else believed that you should have anything nice in the church except them and what they were preaching. And they had been hooked with us for years, and they believed it, and they got stirred up, and Just like we're talking here today, when we showed up, they said, "We got it." And I kind of had to, we kind of had to hold on, didn't we, Mike? We kind of had to hold on because they wanted to show us how fast they would go. And buddy, we ripped down the road. They said, you know, they had the big motor, and they said, "Wow, look," you know. And we thought, well, won't you get a ticket? And they're like, "Oh, they don't care." But they were using these vehicles to go and have crusades with.
Yes.
As well as pick us up. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? But see, they didn't believe that until they heard it. They didn't have it until they acted on it. And they didn't act on it until they believed it. And they didn't believe it till they heard it. And they didn't hear it till somebody preached it. Oh, somebody say glory to God.
Glory to God.
Go to Hebrews 13. I may need a couple extra minutes today. Do you have a few extra minutes? Hebrews 13. This is big. He said that genuine, unfeigned faith that's in you, Timothy, that was in your grandmother. That was in your mother. That influenced you from the time you were a little baby. And it's in you too now. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Did he hear some things around that house growing up?
Yes.
Did he hear about God?
Yes.
Yeah, he did.
Yes.
And it got in him. Now, he's helping Paul.
Yeah. Yes.
Woo!
Yes.
Isn't that great?
Yes.
He's helping Paul. Hebrews 13:7. Says, "Remember them which have the rule over you, who've spoken to you the word of God, whose faith follow." You know, Paul said that a number of times. Follow me as I follow the Christ. Be followers together with me, followers of God. It said, follow their faith, considering the end of their conversation. Now, this is very important here. This is not following their teaching or their teaching on faith per se. This is following the life of faith, looking at what it produced, looking at what came out of it. Conversation is your manner of life. Verse 8, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Why bring that up now in the middle of this? Because you'll see the same characteristics in godly leaders that are right. They don't change. They don't waver. They're not up. They're not down. They're not changing what they preach, what they believe every other month. They're consistent. They're stable. Keep going, verse 9. Don't be carried about with different and strange doctrines. See, that's changing things up. It's a good thing the heart be established with grace, not with foods that have not profited them that have been occupied therein. Another translation of verse 7 said, considering the end of their conversation, follow their faith. Consider the income. The outcome, I should say. The outcome. Think of all the good that has come from their lives and follow the example of their faith. These associations. Go to Genesis. I'm trying to move a little quicker for time's sake. Can you stay hooked? Go to Genesis. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. Genesis 12. He said, Paul said, what you've heard and seen, learned in me, you do that. Do that. And the God of peace will be with you. In Genesis 12, verse 1. The Lord said to Abram, Get out of your country and from your kindred and from your father's house to a land I will show you, and I'll make of you a great nation and bless you and make your name great, and you'll be a blessing. Verse 4, Abram departed as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him. Lot went with him, which was his brother's boy. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. Chapter 13, let me see, look at verse 4, 13, 4. No, let's see, for time's sake, back up to verse 1, I'm moving too quick. Abraham, he went up with all that he had, his wife, and he had stuff. Anybody remember that? I'm getting there. Verse 2, Abram was very rich. Oh, there's that word again. There it is. Who made him that way?
God.
When did God change?
Never.
And say, you know, I don't like that anymore. We did that, but we're doing a new thing now. It's called poor. Well, who changed it then?
Man.
Who changed it?
Man.
Man's religion.
Yes, sir.
Abram was very rich. And in case you got carried away, well, he was rich spiritually. Well, he was. But he also had money. He was very rich in cows and silver and gold. Is that right?
Yes.
And verse 5, and Lot also. Lot also, which went with Abram. He had flocks and herds
and tents.
And tents. How many understand how significant the language is here? What's it telling you? Lot had the same thing Abraham had. But why? Because he was with
Abram.
Right? Because he was with him. So how'd this happen? Well, when they left, when God told Abram to leave, he left and Lot went with him. One of the best moves he ever made. And of course, Abram allowed him to go. And God had pronounced this astonishing blessing on Abram. And everything he put his hand to just multiplied and prospered. And every cow deal he did made money hand over fist. Goat deals, sheep deals, camel deals, grain deals. We got money coming in from every side. And this thing is just compounding. And he must have gave Lot some starter money. Or back then, you know, livestock was currency too. So he gave him some starter cows, some starter sheep, some starter goats, starter donkeys. And so then Lot follows him around and he says, hey, I'm going to the cow sale today. You want to go? Oh, yeah. And he watched how Abram did it. And he watched how he negotiated. And he watched how he prayed and waited on God till he got the answer. Then he watched how he didn't do what the Lord told him not to do. And the next thing you know, what's the next verse say? They got so many cows, the land was not able to bear them, that they might dwell together. Their substance was so great, they couldn't dwell together. And what happened later was the biggest mistake Lot ever made. Because Abram came to Lot and said, we can't have this strife. We're not going to have it. So you tell me what you want to do. And you want to go this way, I'll go that way. Well, he's the elder. Right. It should be his right to choose. Yeah. But that's how faith people are. They're not afraid. They know God will take care of them no matter what. And Lot, to his detriment, he chose the best. He chose the water. He chose the pastures. And he separated from Abram, and that was the beginning of his complete destruction and downfall. And what you'll find, it wasn't the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah that destroyed Lot and his family. It was their separation from Abram. Come on, can you see that? It was their separation. Why? Because, see, it's easy to forget too. When the Lord has blessed you and you're doing pretty well, and you get to thinking, well, I don't need them anymore. Worst mistake he ever made was unhooking. But this plane deal. I was down at Brother Kenneth Copeland's ministry, what was this, a few weeks ago, some things we were doing. And I knew this thing was happening. It hadn't happened yet, but I was confident that it would. And it came up in my heart, and I was able to tell him personally. I said, sir, 20 years ago, was this 05 or 06, whatever that is. Yeah, almost. Well, it's longer than that, right? So you paid cash for a new jet 20 years ago. Brother Copeland, their ministry, some of you that are partners, the Citation 10 team, y'all remember that? And they believed for it for years and didn't borrow and just waited till they had it. And then we went with them to the service center to look at one of them where they made them. And this one was a demo. It had all the bells and whistles. And a month or so after that, they had some more come in, and they paid for that thing. Didn't go in debt for it. Didn't trade it. Just paid for it and brought it home. And we saw that. And it made a mark on us. Right? And it seemed like impossible that we would do something like that. But what, a couple of months ago, Jesse Duplantis, Jesse and Kathy, they paid cash for one. Just about that same amount. Well, see, they saw it too. They saw the same thing we saw. Right? 20 years ago. And this past Wednesday, Faith Life Church and us, we our ministries paid cash for one of these, just about the same amount as 20 years ago.
Hallelujah.
And Phyllis and I, one night this week, we were talking about this, and we said, well, you know, could this have happened if we had never seen that or heard these things? And the Lord brought this passage, Romans 10, that I just read to you. How will they believe? It's something they hadn't heard. So no, you would not. You would not. You would not. And so we've been around them. We were around the Hagans. Brother Kenneth Hagin Sr. and Miss Aretha Hagin, you heard Phyllis talking about, for 20 years. And he taught on faith and traveled and ministered to ministers and had strong ministry tools and resources. And now we teach on faith.
Amen.
Are y'all with me? I'm not saying as good as he did, but I'm saying we teach on faith, and we're reaching people with the faith school and that kind of thing. Can you see what I'm talking about?
Yes.
He did it. We were with him. Now we're doing it.
Yes.
We were around the Copelands. And back, 30 years ago, he had us come and do TV with him in their studio. We had never done that. Didn't have a clue what you were supposed to do, what you were supposed to look like or act like.
Right.
But I watched him real close.
Yeah.
And he gave us pointers and showed us what to do. And we ministered with them for years. And they had TV studios and they had outreach and they had broadcasts and they had aircraft and they traveled the world and they did crusades. Now, 30 years from now, we got TV studio, we got broadcast. Are y'all listening or not? We got aircraft that are paid. Come on, can you see that? Does it matter who you're around
yes.
and what you're watching and what you're listening to?
Yes,
sir. Whew.
Hallelujah.
Now, I'm not claiming we're on the level they're on. I'm not saying that. But back then, we had none of that.
That's right.
And now we got several of the same things.
Yes.
That's God.
Yes.
I said, that's God. That's the goodness of God. It matters so much who you're around, what you're seeing, what you're hearing. That's what he said about his mother and his grandmother. He said that that faith is in them. It's in you. It got in you.
Hallelujah.
Abraham had the blessing of God on him. Next thing you know, he's rich. He's got cows, he's got goats, he's got sheep, he's got camels, he's got silver, he's got gold. He's got hundreds of people to help him take care of it. And you turn around, and next thing you know, Lot. Lot? Who's Lot? Somebody that hung out with Abram. Lot's got cows, and she got the same thing. Is there a connection, association, connection, where increase comes to pass? Now, I got just another thing to talk about in connection with this. Go to Matthew 7. Matthew 7, verse 1. I'm running a little long, but we had extra things today to talk about. The Bible says, Romans 12, 15, you're going to Matthew, but Romans 12, 15 says, rejoice with them that rejoice. Why is that important? And what if you don't? Does it make any difference? Matthew 7, are you there? Verse 1 says, judge not that you be not judged. Next verse. For with what judgment you judge, you shall be judged. Most people don't believe this. And I said, why do you say that, Brother Keith? It's obvious because they keep judging other folks. They don't believe. Romans 2 says this exactly. If you judge somebody else, you just judged yourself. Most people don't believe that. But Jesus said it as clearly as you can say it. That's why he started out by saying, do not judge. Don't. Why? Because with whatever judgment you judge, that's how you are going to be judged. And with whatever measure you meet to it, that's how it's going to be measured to you again. What does that mean? Well, I mentioned our association, for instance, with the Copelands and aircraft. They've been sharply criticized for that. They endured a lot of persecution about those things for decades. But when we saw it, and we heard it, we didn't judge it as wrong. You can judge it as, well, okay, that's okay for them, but we'll never be there. Well, see, you judged it too much for you. So you won't have it. Or you can say, that's just wrong. Do you know what they could do with all that money? Well, what you just did, you won't keep them from getting it, but you will keep you from getting it. You just judged yourself. Now, in Acts 13, verse 44, is it important how you judge somebody else's benefit, somebody else's blessing? It's, you want to say more than important. It's life and death. It's either expanding your future or limiting you. Everybody say rejoice.
Rejoice.
With those that rejoice.
Rejoice.
I know Phyllis and I had been in the ministry for, I don't know, 5 years or so. And Our little cars were junky, and we were able to trade and get a, it was a used car, had some miles on it, but it was a nice car. It was a Oldsmobile. Actually, they don't even make those anymore, do they? Toronado. Black and silver with wire wheels. It was happening, brother. And Phyllis and I were so glad to get it. I drove it to school where I was teaching and ministering and healing school. And some of our staff saw it, and they came out, and they said, "Oh, wow, this is your car." "Yeah, we just got it." And one guy, he jumped up and said, "Woo, glory to God." And he took off and he ran. And he ran around the car, and he said, "Woo!" And he ran around the car. I mean, he shouted a lot more than we did. And he stopped and he said, "Brother Keith, you may wonder why I'm so excited." He said, "You got started in this ahead of me and been going before me, but I'm in the same blessing line. I'm coming right behind you."
Same blessing line.
Was he rejoicing with us? And how is he judging it? Is he judging it too much for him?
No.
Or too much for us?
No.
Because ever how you judge it, that's how you will be judged. See, you can't say, point at somebody and go, "That's just disgusting. That just makes me sick." Well, then you can never have anything like that or of that caliber unless you are a big old hypocrite.
That's right.
Yeah, that's right.
Right?
Yeah, that's right.
You can't. So the right response is, if it's good in any way, if it's nice, right? You go, "Hallelujah. Praise God for you." Acts 13, this is true with ministry. This is true with anything. Paul and his company went and preached and in the synagogues. And I mean, it was groundbreaking. It was the first time a lot of these people had ever heard about Jesus. And so you could, there would have been some tense moments in there first time around, but they made it through. People kind of warmed up and they said, "We want to hear more about this." And man, the word got all over town. And the Bible said next Sabbath day, almost the whole city showed up to hear Paul preach. Verse 44. 13:44, the next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together to hear the word of God. Now let me just stop right there. Is this something everybody should be shouting about?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
Yes. But when the Jews saw the multitudes, the crowds, they were filled with envy and did what?
Spoke against.
Against it. Is this one of the biggest mistakes of their life?
Yes.
Will speaking against it stop the gospel and stop Paul and stop his ministry? What will it stop? Them. Them. It will prevent them from ever having meetings like this or crowds or attendance like this. Do you see why the master said, "Don't judge so you won't be judged"? See, they had been there, some of them, all their life. They never seen a crowd a fraction of this size. The city never got that excited about them. And it made them mad. And they went into comparison. Of course, they didn't realize they're comparing themselves to one of the most anointed ministers that there'll ever be in any generation. They ought to have been thrilled that he was there. Right in their city. But they weren't. They were filled with envy. They spoke against those things spoken by Paul, contradicting and blaspheming. And then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold. And they said, "Well, it was necessary that the word of God could be first spoken to you. But seeing you put it from you, and you what?
Judge
who?" See, they thought they were judging Paul. Come on, can you see this?
Yes.
They thought they were judging them. He said, "No, you just judged yourself unworthy of everlasting life."
Yes.
See, you can't speak against the gospel and be born again by the gospel.
Yes.
You either believe it or you don't.
Right.
You either want it or you don't.
Yes.
He said, since you put it from you, you reject it, and you judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, we're going to go to somebody that wants to hear it.
Yes.
We're going to the Gentiles.
Yes.
They'll hear it.
Yes.
They'll accept it. And that's the way it is with all of the good news.
Right.
There are people who scoff, who mock, who judge, who criticize, who said that just makes me sick. And the sad thing is, they won't stop us or people like us, but they'll never have it.
Right.
They'll never have anything close to it. And it's not because God didn't want them to have it.
Right.
It's because they judge somebody else and judge themselves unworthy.
Yes.
By the grace of God, I'm not going to do that. How about you?
I'm not going.
Everybody stand up with me. Let's pray a prayer. And let's be open for more. Can it get too big for God? What's a big building to God? Huh? He creates stars. What's a TV budget to God? What's an airplane to God? Or a ship or a freight train? Tiny, tiny, tiny stuff. But if it's too big for you and you think it's too big for someone else, then it is too big for you. Say it out loud, Father God.
Father God,
I love you.
I thank you
for your goodness,
for your mercy,
for your kindness.
Oh,
how big you are.
Oh,
how great you are.
Oh,
how good you are.
Truly,
you are able
to
do exceeding abundantly above
anything,
everything,
all
that we ever thought
or
asked,
according to the mighty power
of the greater one
working inside us.
Forgive us, Lord,
for ever judging
negatively
anyone else's
benefit,
our progress,
our increase,
our
blessing.
We say
nothing's too big
for you.
Nothing's
too good,
too
much,
too great
for the gospel,
for
your people,
your ministries,
your
things.
It's
the most important thing
happening.
And we
purpose.
Alert us.
Help
us to be aware
and
think right
and
see right.
And
we purpose
to
rejoice
with
those who
rejoice,
to
be glad
in
the blessing on
our brothers
and
our sisters,
to
rejoice
in
every good thing,
in
every big thing,
in
every great
thing,
and to
give you all
the praise
and
all the glory.
In
Jesus'
name.
Amen,
amen,
amen.
Phyllis,
would you close
for us, please?
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
Lord.
Thank you,
Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let's just bow our heads. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us. And we know that these things are not the most important thing, but these things are just tools for you, Father, to reach the world, to save everyone from dying a death that can't meet you, Father. So, Father, we lift up every person in this place, on the internet, in Branson, and we say, if they're here under the sound of my voice and they don't know you and they want to know you, we lift them up to you, Father. And we say, draw them unto you, Father, by your Spirit. Because these tools, this building, this airplane, everything we have is to reach them so that they can know you, Father. So that they can come to be with you when they go from this earth. And the time is short. So if you're in this place, or you're on the internet, or you're in Branson, and you don't know the Lord, and you want to know the Lord, say this prayer with me. Say, Father God, I want to know you. I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I will live for you all the days of my life. I know that Jesus came and paid the price for me. Paid for all my sins. Washed me clean. That I will never be the same again after today. Now just thank Him. Thank you, 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 Lord. Altar care workers, if you would, come to the front. If you're in here today and you prayed that for the first time, don't go out the back. Come up here to these people. They want to pray with you. And also, if you're in here today and you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit and you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, these people can pray with you. They'll pray and shout just like we were shouting earlier at the beginning of the service. It'll be a great day. It'll be good things happening in your life. If you're in here and the person beside you doesn't know the Lord, love on them. How many of you don't know the person standing next to you? We did this before. How many of you don't know the person standing next to you? Introduce yourself. Take a minute. Introduce yourself to the person standing next to you or behind you or in front of you. Take just a minute. They're going to sing. We'll do that. And if you don't know the Lord, come forward and introduce yourself to Him. Glory to God. We love you. We'll see you on Wednesday night or Friday night or next Sunday. Hug somebody. Take them to lunch. Glory to God. See you next week.
Come.